Now, over the years, my friends, I have spent some time trying to explain to this audience of people here who liberals are and what they believe and why they believe it. And in one of the specific efforts that I have made repeated attempts to explain to you why the American left does not appear to love America. Instead, they have deep feelings of anger about America. You've heard me say it once, you've heard me say it a gazillion times. They do not believe in American exceptionalism. They don't believe in American greatness. They believe America was founded in an unjust, unfair, and in some cases, illegal manner. They think there's nothing worthy of celebrating about the United States. It's imperfect, and it can be perfected, but only if they are responsible for it. They do not believe that we are a legitimate superpower. They believe that our superpower status is the result of theft, that we have behaved as an imperial people, and we have conquered the world, and we have gone everywhere we've gone and stolen what we wanted, and we've brought it back. And that's why we're so economically successful, and that's why we are so rich and wealthy compared to the other nations of the world, because we have stolen what we have. We have not legitimately produced it, and therefore our country is illegitimate. And I've had people say, Rush, don't you think that's a little excessive? Don't you think that's a little? No, it's not excessive at all. I've even gone further in explaining why the left is for complete, total open borders. They believe poverty around the world is the fault of the United States. If we had not gone to Central America and had the CIA murdering leaders and installing our own people, if we'd not gone to the Middle East, if we'd not gone to Europe, and if we'd not plundered these places, the rest of the world wouldn't want to come here. But because we have stolen the world's riches, and because we have plundered the rest of the world, they have no choice but then to come here. And as such, we should let them in. Somebody wants to come to our country to improve their life, and especially if their life is in bad shape because of us in the first place, well, we should let them. And I've had people say, don't you think that's a bit of an exaggeration? Don't you think you're going a little bit overboard on that? I mean, you want people to believe what you're saying, but that sounds so odd that it may sound odd. What it is unconventional. What it is, these are truths that very few people will utter or say for whatever reasons. But I come to you today with a little bit of evidence. As I always do, I always have evidence, facts, news, whatever to back up my claims. And I was just rummaging around doing show prep last night, and I came across a headline. Martin Sheen blames U.S. for ruining Central America, causing immigration. I said, well, looky here. Exactly what I've been saying. Exactly. Thank you, Emilio. His name is Emilio Estevez, right? Is he Emilio or is one of his kids Emilio? He's Emilio. Okay. Martin Sheen. This is the guy. I remember when this program first started, 1988, August 1st, 1988, about a month later, Martin Sheen was the mayor of Malibu or something, and he wanted to import a bunch of homeless people into Malibu because of the way they were being mistreated. This was the guy that had banded together with the now famous Mitch Snyder, the homeless advocate. Who would want to advocate for homelessness? These are the people that thought a shopping cart was a legitimate home. Anyway, this guy would get together with Mitch Snyder, who lived in Washington, and they would go to Washington on cold nights, and they would kick the homeless off their sleeping grates and sleep on themselves to show solidarity with the homeless. So what I wanted to do, I wanted, might not have the first month, but I mean, it was in the first year. I wanted to charter a bus and put a bunch of homeless people, round them up here in Los Angeles, and drive them to Malibu, because this is what Martin Sheen said he wanted to do. And I was discouraged from doing this by my syndication partners because of potential litigation. If any of the homeless on my chartered bus had gotten injured, I would be liable. They ran in there and said, don't do this. You can talk about doing it, but don't actually charter a bus and put the homeless on it. You don't know who's going to end up on the bus. So I didn't do it. I mean, it was made, Johnny Carson did a week's worth of stuff on this. Well, that's who this guy is, Martin Sheen, okay? Appearing as a guest on the Tavis Smiley Show Monday on PBS, liberal actor Martin Sheen claimed the United States is to blame for causing so many immigrants to leave Central American countries and travel to the U.S. as he complained about past interventions in some of those countries. He concluded, "We're looking at what we have wrought." My friends, I do not make this up. I know these people like every square inch of my glorious naked body, not just the back of my hand. I know them. I know what they think. I know what they're going to think before they realize it. I know what they're going to do. Sheen's comments came during a discussion after the host, Tavis Smiley, brought up Trump's recent decision to end the DACA program that benefits young illegal immigrants. After Sheen commented that it is important to defend these young people, the PBS host suggested that there's hatred for illegal immigrants. And he said, "Take me back. I want to juxtapose, or have you juxtapose for me, Martin, the hatred that you had to endure when you started out as an actor all those years ago. And the name, oh, it's Ramon. He's Ramon Estevez. And that name, Ramon Estevez, didn't serve you so well." So he had to change his name to Martin Sheen. He changed his name to Sheen because he liked Bishop Sheen. Yeah, one of his sons is Emilio. Is that Charlie or is that the other one? The other one. I'm having him in a block. Anyway, they are the Estevez fan. I have no problem with that. They're the ones that change your name, not me. Tavis Smiley's bringing it up here. The hatred that you experienced with the same kind of hatred that you see this week, that you've seen this week that's been, you know, applied against the very same people. So there's hatred out there, folks. All because Trump wants to rescind an unconstitutional presidential executive action, the DACA deal. By the way, well, have to get into this in a moment, but, you know, I've been suggesting, I put forth, look, nobody wants to round up these kids and kick them out of the country, right? Nobody wants to round them up and deport them. Although most of them aren't kids anymore. Some of them still are. Saw something that 30% of the 800,000 that Obama granted entry have engaged in some kind of criminal activity, some of it misdemeanor, some felony. But the point is, they're not kids anymore. But the American people are not going to sit by, just watch kids rounded up and sent back home. So why don't you get something for it? If you're going to go ahead and legalize this, get funding for the wall. Get something. You're the art of the deal. Get something. You like Chuck and Nancy. Now you're doing a lot of deals with Chuck. But there's more deals coming up with Chuck and Nancy. Do you know this? Tax reform. Trump may do tax reform with Chuck and Nancy. Got it right here. It's in audio soundbite number two. Coming up. Don't go anywhere. So he's not going to get anything. It doesn't appear that he's going to demand funding for the wall in either whatever he plans to do with DACA or this deal he did with Chuck and Nancy on the debt ceiling and some of the other items that were in that deal. Anyway, back to this. Martin Sheen recounted what his life was like when he was younger and trying to get into acting. Smiley followed up with another question about immigration. "If we are a nation of immigrants," said Smiley, "what's happened that's caused this to happen? What is it about the story that we're writing at this moment that's caused us to turn on immigrants, if we're a nation of immigrants?" Now, you see here, the trick for these people is to never draw a distinction between legal and illegal immigration. They just treat all immigration as legal. And why? Well, because we deserve it. We deserve to find out the rest of the way the world really lives because we caused it. We're responsible for the pain and suffering because we have plundered and we have stolen and we've steamrolled over these smaller countries, smaller people. And it's no wonder they hate us. They're justified. It's no wonder they want to come here and get back what we stole from them. Here, Martin Sheen is essentially admitting all of this. So I just wanted to bring your attention to this. And he said, Martin Sheen, not elected Democrat. He doesn't speak. He does. They all think the same way, folks. They're automatons. That's the point about them. You have to believe the same things or you're thrown out. You have to say the same things or they will shut you up. It's what we were talking about yesterday when it comes to groupthink and consensus. And here's something I just wanted to mention. That's it. That's a sum total. I just wanted to give you evidence. Some people said you're going a little overboard in the way you're describing it. No, this is what they think. That is how, in their minds, they moralize the legitimacy of allowing immigrants to break the law and come here because they deserve to be exempted because we've basically made them poor. And then they run around, and this is part and parcel of their never-ending attacks on the founding and the decency of the country. An author and journalist came under fire on social media yesterday after she tweeted a reply to an anti-looting warning from Miami police by saying, "The carceral state is inseparable from white supremacy." What she means is that police officers are arresting looters. Where I live, the only people allowed on the island in South Florida are residents and EMS people right now. That's called, I think they're calling it phase two. Phase three is when employees, people that own businesses but don't live there, can return. Like we couldn't do the EIB network program the other day because the staff who doesn't live there was not be allowed on the island. And the reason for this, and it's not just Palm Beach, it's all over South Florida, it's to keep looters out. The biggest problem they've got, because every criminal mind knows that there are a lot of homes unoccupied, a lot of homes that didn't suffer a lot of damage unoccupied, that people got the hell out. And so they are just sitting duck targets. So the police are doing everything they can to keep the criminal element out. And for the most part, they're doing a good job. But when they find looters, either of public property or private property, small business, they're arresting them. And this author is calling that white supremacy. You see, even criminals in a time of disaster have a right to what they see in the store, even if they can't afford it. In fact, even more if they can't afford it, because that's unfair and that's unjust. And that's another reason why America is a bad place. And so these people are just trying to survive, and to arrest them is nothing more than white supremacy. You have to look up carceral. It means having to do with prison. It's part of the root word of incarceration. The Miami Police Department took to Twitter on Sunday as Hurricane Irma, which, by the way, not as strong as predicted, which, by the way, only did one-third the amount of damage that was predicted, which, by the way, is still bad, but which, by the way, is not what was predicted. I will get in trouble for pointing this out. Anyway, the Miami Police Department took to Twitter on Sunday as Hurricane Irma battered the state. Here was the tweet. "You thinking about looting? Ask these guys how that turned out for them." That's what the tweet said. And there was a photo of people inside a jail cell. Though Sarah Jaffe's tweet on Monday garnered 1,500 likes, it sparked more than 100 comments, many of which were critical and accused her of being racist. She's the police, so she's the law enforcement official. And that's when this author came out and said, this is racist, this is white supremacy. White supremacy to enforce the law. According to one of her several online biographies, Ms. Jaffe is a Nation Institute fellow and an independent journalist covering labor, economic justice, social movements, politics, gender, and pop culture. Her work has appeared in The Nation, in Salon, The Week, The American Prospect, The Washington Post, The Atlantic, and many other publications. So she has a wide distribution network. She wrote, "They have prisons, crime, and private property in Nigeria, too, and Egypt, and India. Nothing to do with white supremacy, poverty." Oh, that's a responder wrote that, not her. Jaffe is the author of the book, Necessary Trouble, Americans in Revolt. Anyway, the point is, she's not alone in thinking this. That it is white supremacy. It fits their narrative of the day, that enforcing the law is white supremacy, because who founded the nation? A bunch of white guys. Who founded the nation and wrote the laws? A bunch of white guys. What were they? They were racist pigs in their way of thinking. And so it just, the Democrat Party wonders why it can't win elections. And it's only going to get worse the more they keep this up, because they are not in any way, shape, manner, form representative of even half, not even half of the way people in this country think. Let's take a quick time out. We'll be back and continue after this. Don't go away. Here we have the audio. Grab audio soundbite number 21. Back to this Martin Sheen. I want you to hear this. He was on the Tavis Smiley Show Friday on PBS. And the question, what is it about the story that we're writing at this moment, Mr. Sheen, that caused us to turn on immigrants if we're a nation of immigrants?
There is not a nation between Mexico and Panama that has not been affected by the United States, either militarily, economically, or outright colonialized, mm-hmm. you know, all of Central America. Most of these people are coming from these countries. The war in El Salvador, for example, so many hundreds of thousands of Salvadorians fled that war. We were supporting this very conservative right-wing, basically military mm-hmm. dictatorship all those years until it was finally, peace accord was achieved. The same thing in Nicaragua. We invaded that country how many times in the last century and in this century, and control their governments, control their economy. So all of the immigrants that are in the country from those countries and whose children came with them mm-hmm. as tiny ones, and some that have been born here, probably would not be here in such numbers if it hadn't been for our involvement in their countries in this hemisphere.
See? I mean, I do not make this stuff up. They are coming because we've made them poor. They are coming because we've stolen from them. We've dominated them economically, politically, socially. We've given them no choice but then to come here, where they're essentially looking for what we stole from them so they can take it back. It's kind of like the same thinking that goes behind, how did the rich get rich? They stole it from the poor. That's what they say Reagan's trickle-down economics was. Well, the rich get rich on the backs of the poor. I've never understood the math of that. How does anybody get rich taking from the poor? But people fall for it. Now, in this case, why is there poverty in the world? Why is there poverty in Central America? By the way, we didn't invade Nicaragua. The Soviet Union was attempting to establish another Cuba there. That's what the Sandinista and the Contra thing was all about. During the Reagan years, we were trying to prevent a Soviet client state, another one in our hemisphere, in Nicaragua. Daniel Ortega was their henchman. We didn't invade anything. They, the Soviets, invaded our hemisphere, and we were simply defending ourselves. But the reason there is poverty in the world, folks, is because of the unequal distribution of capitalism. But people like Martin Sheen thinks that there's not enough communism, that capitalism is to blame, because capitalism's unfair. Capitalism is where America is what America is. And look at America. America's the richest place in the world. He doesn't see that, well, maybe if we had a more equal distribution of capitalism, people in Central America wouldn't need to come here because their countries would be economically growing and sufficient and so forth. Don't see it that way at all. See us as the enemy, see us as the culprit, and this defines the American left today, and certainly the American leftist radicals. And this is, it's one of the many reasons that the Democrat Party is going to continue to lose elections.